All right, please. Father, we thank you for your grace, your goodness, your many blessings. Thank you, Father, for every good and every perfect gift, all from above, from the Father of lights, for whom there is no girl but his name of shadow eternity. Father, we thank you for the work you've begun in us. We believe you have begun the good work within us. You shall continue to perform it. We give you praise, we give you the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to ask those that maybe have a testimony. We had some outstanding testimonies in prayer, one of the morning sessions. So you that maybe wanted to share something that God has placed, revelation you had, something that God did in your life during the prayer. Amen. Because we're going to be doing more of it this week. Amen. We're going to be having special prayer this week. Monday night, we're going to give you instructions. We're going to do some things that will build you up. We're going to hopefully have some handouts prepared for your Monday night. So I will be praying with you, along with Brother Travis will be here. I'll be here on Monday night, and I'm going to be praying specifically for you individually. We're going to be fasting and praying this week. Fasting and praying. I'm going to ask everybody to join in. The entire week will be given to consecration. We'll give you instructions on the end today. Amen. Is there anybody that wants to have a testimony of how the Lord has blessed you?
Together, we're starting to ride together, we're starting to talk, we're starting to
able to communicate together. And you know, sometimes when God blesses you, it's not always something that's going to make you feel good. Sometimes God blesses you when he makes you feel different, makes you feel strange, makes you feel weird, makes you face yourself. Kind of like Michael Jackson says, the man in the mirror. And he makes you look in the mirror at yourself. And so at that point, you have to accept some things. And So I'm now being able to accept that I'm not always in charge, and that I'm not always right, and that I'm not always know-it-all. And so in accepting those things, the prayer has been able to do that. But you know, the big thing that prayer has been able to do for me is to continue on. Because one of the problems I would have in life is get to a point where it's kind of one of those things where you hear itchy ear stuff on Sunday and you're feeling good Monday, but by Tuesday, it's gone. But now prayer is helping me to sustain day after day after day. And that's the big thing for my life. And with my wife, I think my wife is now learning to accept and also to learn. Brother Travis and I talked about it. People have to learn what's going on in someone's life that's making them act the way they act. It's not always just about what the devil is doing to you. Sometimes it's just what we're doing to ourselves. I thank God, and thank you also, church family, for your acceptance.
Amen.
Okay, that was good. That was good.
Amen.
You want to say something, Sister? Okay, brother. Okay, come on, Sister. We'll keep the bubbles together.
First of all, I give honor to God, and He is the head of my life. And as I was saying, I guess I gave a testimony, but it was something that I had to say. I told my family the day that I joined this church that something happened. I had to be here. I had to go and tell somebody what came over me. I tried to tell my family. They said, oh, okay, that's nice. But I guess I was looking for an acceptance, like, great. So when I didn't get it from my family, thank God, I have a cousin that's blessed me. She has blessed me. She's been here with me through my trial and tribulations. She talked to me when I needed somebody to talk to. So when I called her, and she's down in Alabama all by herself with her family, you know, we're not there. So when I called her and told her what happened to me, we just started glorifying over the phone. I know my phone could have bugged out on it, but I just had to let her know. I'm sitting here at work, not working, just sitting on the phone talking and just praising God together. And after we got there, I just felt so wonderful. Because I knew, she knew what I was feeling. She kept me encouraged where I didn't have that courage from my family that was going to support me. Like, okay, you got this. But she gave me, and she always told me, God got your back. He is never going to leave you or forsake you. You just keep your head up. Keep walking the way you need to walk. Don't look back. Let everything else roll off of you. God is going to bless you. And since me and my husband had this little family thing going on, and I pray, God has been blessing me. I can walk around with a smile on my face every day. I can turn that frown into a smile.
I love you so much. I love you. Glory. All right, brother. Dr. Dennis. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
All right. You know what? One of the things that Pastor's been telling us about is pray and pray hard, mm-hmm. and let it come from your belly.
Yes.
If you're looking for a new weight loss treatment,
Let me tell you, this is it. Look at this.
Nerves are all clogged up in my back again, and he said, first surgery I took, the doctor did it wrong. He messed me up. This doctor, Dr. Bird, was fabulous. I went to surgery on February the 3rd. I could walk that night. Praise God.
Favorite scriptures, and I
I can remember the scripture. I mean, almost in my sleep, I can remember the scripture. And I guess the first scripture that was quickened to me when we were being raised out in the country, we used to have a pastor that came every other week. And the Sundays that we didn't have a pastor there, we would just have Sunday school, and that was about it on Sunday. Okay, but I remember all of those pastors, they specialized in Hebrews 12, 14. Follow peace with all men, and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. So holiness is a prerequisite for receiving, for seeing the Lord, a prerequisite. And there are a lot of different ways that we can explain this, but we're going to give you some of the different ways that we need to look at what holiness is and the benefits that holiness brings into your life. The scripture that my brother always preached from, Titus 2, 11 through 12. This is a scripture that you heard me talk about a lot. I just want you to turn there and Titus 2, verses 11 through 12. For the grace of God, everybody just say, for the grace of God, that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. The grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. Amen. So it's the grace of God that brings salvation. We're saved by grace. And it's a gift of God, and it's not something that we have to work for. Somebody said all we have to do is believe. Believe. And believing is the only thing you can do without doing anything. Amen. For the grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared to all men. So this has been made available to all men. Jesus came and died for the entire world, teaching us that denying ungodliness, amen, teaching us that denying ungodliness. See, God gives us grace to deny ungodliness. You have to say no, amen, to ungodliness. Say no. You have a grace that gives you the ability to say what? No. To what? Ungodliness.
That's right. Amen.
Amen. The grace of God has what? Been made accessible and available to all men. Amen. Teaching us that we can what? Deny ungodliness. You know, amen, you can live a life free and separated from sin. How many believe that?
Amen.
How many believe that?
Amen.
Amen. If, you know, it's possible. It's, I mean, not possible, but it's a command, and we don't have no option, because if you don't live a life free and separated from sin, people are not going to have any respect for you.
That's right.
Even as a Christian, as a believer.
Amen.
You know, it's not good enough to talk about a mile and walk about an inch. Amen. We have to what? Live what we confess to be.
That's right.
Is that right?
Amen.
We project the wrong image if we don't what? Live what we say. Amen. So we have the ability to live an overcoming life. You know, the scriptures that I was reading on, they say that, let me see. How does this go? Jesus, 1 John 3, 8, for this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. So, Jesus comes to destroy the works of the devil. In other words, to put Satan's works to naught. Amen. We don't have to obey the dictates of our flesh any longer. We don't have to, amen, be governed by the dictates of our flesh. Amen. Scripture says that sin shall not reign over us. Tell somebody, sin is not supposed to reign over you. I mean, it's not supposed to what? Rule and control or dominate your life. Amen. Sin, because this is what the blood of Jesus, this is what the redemption was all about, to destroy the power that Satan formerly had over us, to bring that power to null. Amen. Scripture says, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God says what? No. Amen. Some people believe the more you sin, the more grace you receive. So they just keep on sinning because I get more grace. Amen. Whoever looks at it from that perspective, they're just kind of sick in the mouth. But we're not to continue in sin. In fact, the scripture says, whosoever is born of God does not commit sin. Amen. Now, what does that mean? Some of us don't know. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he's born of God. You can just write that down, 1 John 3:8, I believe. Man. Yes, man, right. All right, so we can live without habitually sinning. Amen. Y'all repeat that with me. We can live. Amen. We can live without what? Habitually sinning. Because the grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared unto what? All men, teaching us that we can deny what? Ungodliness and what? Worldly lust. All right? Everybody just said we can deny ungodliness and worldly lust. Ungodly plucks up, pops up, confronts us, then it's our responsibility to what? To use the grace of God. How many believe you have the grace of God on the inside of you?
Amen.
Amen. Y'all used to tell me that the grace of God is sufficient. Amen. The saints used to say that. The grace, amen. God said what? My grace is what? Sufficient. God's grace. Amen. How many know that God has saving grace? Amen. Amen. How many been saved from the guttermost to the uttermost?
Amen.
Changed from the alley rat to the aristocrat?
Yes. Amen.
Amen. How many of you are different now?
Yeah.
All right. Well, that's saving grace. How many can say he's saving grace?
Amen.
All right, just like God has saving grace, God has what? Keeping grace. Right? God has a grace for every need you have.
Amen.
Everything. Amen.
Amen.
We used to sing a song. I heard this in Memphis. He said, oh Zion, what's the matter now? Oh Zion, what's the... In other words, what is your excuse now? If a person say I can't live without sin, they'll just say that I just don't want to. Because the grace of God that has brought salvation and what? Equipped us, anointed us, and empowered us to live a life. All you have to do is have a what? Have a desire. Amen. I remember when I first got saved down in Arkansas, it took me about 3 hours before what got all that mess out of me. I was a rough one. Grew up in the church 21 years. I never, in all of those services and prayers, never made a dent on me. Never felt the power of God one time in 21 years, raised up and holding this church. You know, I had to be hard. Holding this church, yeah, I was holding this church. Did that happen? Signs and wonders, gifts of the Spirit. And I never said nothing all that time. Pretty tough enough to say. I had a buddy, my friend, my first cousin was just like me. And he still ain't saved. Same age, retired policeman. The thing that cracked my heart shell was that somebody was living a holy life. And somebody was used of God, and they were used of God in the gifts of the Spirit. And that one day, I was there. I had a dream that night that the Lord saved me. But that lady said, I hear me tell this over and over, I'm glad for that lady. She said, death, 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 death. And I was running scared, living scared. because all of my life, my mother and my, you know, my relatives, they were praying for me to be saved, but they made me go to the altar almost every time an altar call was made. But I never felt nothing. I never experienced nothing. I never got saved. But when this lady, after dreaming this for years, Bible says the will of transgressors, what heart? After dreaming this for many years, every night when I went to bed, I just prayed that the Lord didn't take me. That I wouldn't die and lose my soul. I knew that hell would be my destiny if I died like I was. And that prophecy, that day, it rang the bell when she said, death. She said, somebody's going to die. That's what I was thinking she was saying. Somebody's going to die. And they're going to die today in this church. She said, death, 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 death in this church today. And I thought it was meaning me. It was two of us seeking the Lord. Everybody else was in good shape, saved, being used of God. Only me and my buddy. Not the policeman. He wasn't, amen. He ain't, amen. He still ain't saved. But my buddy was trying to get married to a young lady. And she said she's not fucking with him happy until he got saved. So he was trying harder than I was. And they said, death, death. And he was really trying. I looked over at him. He was like, he was really into it. And, you know, only two of us there that weren't saved. And he was, seemed like he was almost about to get his breakthrough. And I looked over at him and she said, death. And she said, death today in this church. So it didn't take a rocket scientist to figure that out. I just said, it's got to be me. And for the first time in my life, I got rid of my pride, opened my mouth, just like Brother Rod is trying to get over, and cried and screamed and gave God everything I had until I broke and cried and fell out under the power of God. Amen. Praise God. Oh, the Lord worked me over for about 3 hours. Prayed in the Spirit. I don't know what all I did in the Spirit. I was rolling up and down. Yeah, most of us don't get that saved today. Just roll from the back to the front. I've seen people roll from the back of the church to the front of the church. I mean, under the power, under the anointing of the Holy Ghost. As a result of that, after about 3 hours, when I got up, I said, if any man be in Christ, I'm a new creature. He is a new creature. Old things have what passed away. That was the first time in my life I had ever surrendered my life, because I was bashful, I was ashamed. I would open my mouth in front of anybody. I didn't want nobody looking down my mouth. I didn't want no tears in my face looking ugly. And in those days, they used to pray the Lord until they used to have fun. They call it what?
Purging.
Amen. It was just like foam just run all the way down. And sometimes they would just say, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And that foam, so I'm hanging there, dripping down. Amen. We don't get that saved today. Somebody said, well, that don't make you saved, but I do think that many times they did surrender more and yielded more. Amen. At least they lived all their life and they came to church. And they testified, shouted. Amen. Praise God. But after it was all said and done, I had received the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the mission was accomplished. The sister that was giving this testimony, she was talking about spiritual death. She said there's spiritual death in this church. And not necessarily just means being spiritually dead, but a lot of spiritual death exists in the body of Christ. And she was just giving a general prophecy, and I interpreted it to mean that I was going to die physically, and I was going to die that particular day in the church. And that's the thing that caused me to let go and let God have his way. I never have regretted that time that I fully surrendered to God. Very few people ever come to the point ever where they fully surrender to God. I tell you, if you fully surrender to God, and I think that it takes a full surrender to God, Amen. In order for you to live an overcoming life. How many can say amen? If you just yield a little bit, then you're just going to what? Receive a little bit. You know, sometimes people have a philosophy just a little damn to do. Just like grill cranks. All you need is a little damn. A little damn to do. Amen. But I received Christ that day. And that's been, Lord have mercy, that was in 60. Amen. 65. Amen. The year that I finished. Amen. And I tell you, ever since then, okay, 1961, so she doesn't have to get me straight on that. 61. Amen. She has to keep me straight. Because I mean, if you want everything to work out right, you just watch her. Just follow. All right. Praise the Lord. How many glad that the grace of God that brings salvation has been made accessible and available to all of us?
Yes, amen. Amen.
Amen. You can live an overcoming life. You don't have to lie when it's convenient.
Come on,
now. Sometimes people say, well, even just a peacemaking lie. Just a little white lie. It's not a real bad lie. But a lie is a lie, right? All unrighteousness is sin. That's one definition of sin. All unrighteousness is what? Sin. If it ain't right, it's wrong. Is that, it don't take much to understand that. If it's not right, it's what? If it's almost right, it's what? Still wrong. Amen. They used to teach humbleness of hell. Amen. But if you teach that too strong now, amen, our congregation would be kind of like this. All right. Praise God. Teaching us that denying ungodliness and what? Worldly lust. That we can live what? We can live what? We should live what? Soberly. Everybody just said we should live what? Soberly. Amen. We should live what?
Soberly.
What does sober mean? What does sober mean?
The right mind.
Clear mind.
All right. Soberly means what?
Clear mind.
Yeah. Not left
the mind. All right. Sober means you are what? You're alert, right? You have to be watchful. You have to be alert. Amen. You have to be able to discern between what? Evil and good. Is that right? You got to have that judgment. Is that right? Amen. Praise God. We should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. And a lot of times people say, well, nobody can live sanctified in this life. Amen. You only get sanctified when you die. When you die, that's when you get sanctified. Amen. You know, preachers used to preach this. We're prone to sin as the sparks fly up. We're prone to err. I sin. This is what preachers many times have preached. I sin, you sin. Everybody sin. Man is prone to sin as the sparks fly up. You know, that's the reason why you have so many people in churches that don't even try to live a life that's free and separated from sin, because many times their leaders tell them that they can't live free. Now, if you just want to have illicit sex bad enough, amen, just go ahead and do it, and that's the Lord to forgive you. Amen. They call that cheap grace, right? They call it cheap grace. Just ask them. You just sin as much as you want. Amen. And every time you sin, you got to what? Got an advocate? All you have to do is what? Ask the Lord to forgive you, because the scripture does say he's just and what?
Faithful
to forgive you of your sins and what? Cleanse you from all unrighteousness. But I don't think that we should use, amen, give the flesh an opportunity to commit sin over and over and over. I believe this way. I believe that if you have got a problem, and a lot of times saints do have what? Problems that's not so easily, amen, resolved when they first get saved. Everybody's going to get completely free from everything. Right? Amen. Some don't get free from, amen, the right use of their tongue in a long time. takes a long time to get control of that, right? Y'all say amen. So if it doesn't have to, how many of you is anything hard for God?
No.
Is God's grace sufficient?
Yes.
Can God get control of your child right away if you yield it? If you yield, so the Bible says, yield your members as what? Instruments of righteousness. Amen. The reason why people don't get control of that tongue, they don't do what the Bible says. The Bible says what? Be slow to speak. And what? Slow to hear.
Amen.
Right? Amen. You have to weigh your words. You have to think through things. Never get so, amen, praise God, what you call it. Never get so out of control until you permit your mouth. Amen. You put your mouth in what? Third gear before you get your mind in what? First. Amen. You have to think. Amen. I tell you, somebody that's better than I am in controlling words. Somebody better than I am. Amen. Let me see if I can find something. I don't care what you say. I don't care how many bad stuff. I don't care how high the pitch of your voice is. He's always going to be cool and calm. And she's going to be in control.
Amen.
Amen. That's pretty good. That's good. That's good. The Bible says the person that's able to control their tongue, they are perfect people. Perfect. They have a perfect. They can control everything else. How many want to control everything else? How many? Need a whole lot of self-control. Well, just watch your words, because your words is the thing that what determines whatever you will be, whatever, you know, environment you will live in, amen, and whatever power you're going to exert over your body is going to be through the words that you speak. Amen. So I suggest that living a holy life is something that, because the scripture says that we can absolutely live a life that's free and separated from sin. We don't have to lose control of our temperament. Amen. You just have to what? Make up your mind that when the opportunity, how many of the opportunities will come up a whole lot of times? All right, I'm going to tell you what you can do. You're almost about to give up personal pieces of your mind. What you don't need to do, because you ain't got quite enough for yourself. You know what the Bible says? Put your hands over your mouth.
All right.
What somebody say? How does this relate to holiness? It relates to everything, because the Bible says that your tongue is the what? It's the most unruly member that you have. It's full of deadly poison.
Yes.
It can cause a whole lot of what? Mess.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
It's the most deadly member that you got. And that's the reason why Pastor has actually been encouraging you not to use your member, which is your tongue, which is the main unruly member, as an instrument of sin unto, you know, death. But to use it as an instrument unto righteousness. In other words, learn to use your mouth as an instrument, as a way, a channel, to build yourself up. If you would do that, that's the key to getting victory over, amen, the lack of restraint coming from your mouth. You have to make a practice of building yourself up. Amen. Okay, what I mean by this, the Lord is the strength of my life. Amen. The Lord is the strength. Everybody just say that.
The Lord is the strength of my life.
Amen. The Lord is the strength of my life.
Amen.
I can do all things. That will strengthen me. Amen. Praise God. So you have to be able to regurgitate or recapture scriptures on a consistent basis that will keep you in control. And I like praying the word. I like it. Amen. I don't care how y'all, you know, look like sometimes, you know, just a pastor, you know, just my mouth used to be. We pray too loud. Gets too excited. I like quiet prayer. You know, quiet prayer, the family coming, twirl the thumbs. Don't lift the voice. Don't do like Brother Rod said. I started up. But basically, just a relaxed day. I don't feel like doing no hound dog preaching anyway. But the thing is that I started out in my early walk with the Lord praying with everything I had. And it just got worse. The older I get, the worse it gets. You know, I try to give God everything I have. Well, the Bible says, bless the Lord. Oh, my soul, and what? All that is what? Within me. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and forget not all of his what? Amen. How many know all that's within you means more than just passively, casually worshiping the Lord? Amen. Now, I can understand why people never measure up to the level that God has really planned for them to measure in terms of holiness. The reason why they are distracted from the street, from the highway of holiness, because although the scripture says that we have saving grace, we have keeping grace, we have what? Ministering grace. They call it saving grace, keeping grace, or standing grace, or and ministering grace. We have grace for every need that we have as in the realm of our Christian walk. We have the grace to do it. The grace of God has already what? Been released. When you got saved, when you got filled with the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, amen, was released into your life. You became the righteousness of God. You received His holiness. You were sanctified.
Yes.
The power of Satan over your life came to a screeching halt. Amen. You have to reckon yourself what? Dead. You have to what? Confess the fact that you've been delivered from the power of darkness. You don't ever say anything. Although all of this work has been done in your life, it's not going to mean a hill of beans hearted if you don't what? Come into agreement what has been what? Released into your life. You have to what? Come into agreement. You have to acknowledge it. If any man be in Christ, he is a what? A new creature. Old things have what? Passed away. And behold, all things are what? Now, if you repeated that pretty often, once or twice per week, I believe that would automatically eliminate some of those temptations that you would have to get out of control. Amen. I mean, the Bible said you overcome by the blood of the Lamb. I mean, the blood's already been shed, right?
Right.
Jesus ain't going to go to the cross again.
Amen.
Right? He's already what? Done everything he needs to do. So we overcome by what? What Jesus has already done.
All right.
The blood of the Lamb.
Yes.
And the rest of it have to be what? Man would say. And the word of our what? Testimony.
Yes. Amen.
What are you saying about what God has done for you? Aging on the outside, but the inner man don't age. I'm a miracle creature. And I wish I could get more of y'all to agree with what God has already what? Said about you. What God has already what? Done for you. You are a what? New creature. If a person was saying enough until their consciousness of themselves would be, I'm a new creature. Old things have already passed away. I'm in Christ. And if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. I believe the desire to fulfill the lust of the flesh will begin to what? Diminish. It will begin to diminish. Because you have the power to change the degree that your flesh exercises dominion over your life. You have the power to do that. I'm going to look this thing in. Y'all hear it? Y'all hear it today?
Yes.
The power of life and death is in your tongue. If you don't ever agree with scriptures like, I'm complete in him, he's the head. All principality and power, I'm complete. From the top of my head to the bottom of my feet, inside and out. Christ lives in me, and he is a glory. He is my ability. Come on, listen here. He's my ability. He's my strength.
He's my strength.
Hey. And it's not by power or by what? My ability. It's not by the human efforts that I exert that I can live and overcome in life. It's all by what? The grace of God. Grace of God that brings salvation.
Yes.
Amen. I can do all things through Christ. If I were you, I would say, I can do all things through Christ.
Yes.
That what?
Yes.
Amen. Praise God. The mouth of the upright shall deliver them.
Amen.
Because the power of life and death is in your what? So the mouth of a what? Upright. Everybody say, I'm the upright. My mouth. The secret is keeping the word of God in your life.
Yes, yes, amen.
Hey. That's the reason why, who's that Paul said? His grace is sufficient. God told him, my grace is what? Sufficient. Because in my weakness, I'm what? I'm still strong.
Yes.
Because I'm not operating according to what? The degree or the extent of my grace,
yes,
or my strength. But I'm operating. Amen. Through the Lord, grace of God.
Yes.
How many know the grace of God is powerful?
Yes.
Amen. If y'all don't see this power, come on, kill me, amen. Y'all say. Hey!
Yes.
Sometimes I just like to holler out. Hey! Grace is temptation for me to what?
Amen.
Do what you shouldn't be doing. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. How many love him today? How many love him today? Try to remember what I prayed before. I don't try to remember what I prayed before. You know what I do? I just kind of just worship the Lord, and the Lord will kind of lead you, and the Lord might just bring anything, you know, to your spirit.
That's right.
Because the Lord God is a, you know, sun and shield. And sometimes it's just the Lord is my what? Shepherd. And I shall not want. Amen. I mean, just let him know that you what? You appreciate him being what he is to you. He's a shepherd. How many know what a shepherd is? A shepherd is a person that what? Assumes responsibility for every need that you will have. I mean, he what? He takes care of the whole program.
Yes, he does.
How many? He watches over you. How many can say? And I shall not want. And how many can just lift your voice and say, Lord, you are more than enough. Yes. spiritually and godly in this present world. I believe that this overcoming life is a life that you live in the Spirit. Everybody just say, you got to live in the Spirit. Say it again. You got to live in the life. Now, our business, now everybody in the same business I am, I'm in the Jesus business. You might need to write this down. Philippians 3:3. I worship God in the Spirit. That's the secret of overcoming. You overcome by the blood and the word of the testimony. I worship God in the Spirit. That's the reason why I praise God. Amen. I worship God in the Spirit. Everybody just say, I worship God.
I worship God in the Spirit.
Say it again.
I worship God in the Spirit.
Say it again.
I worship God in the Spirit.
All right. I rejoice in Jesus Christ.
I rejoice in Jesus Christ.
Okay, let me see how good y'all rejoice in this.
Thank you. Joseph, and I'll be clean. I'll be more clean than spotless. Isaiah said, let's reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they can be as clean as the newly driven snow. This morning, on, drink in His presence this morning. Come on, drink in His presence this morning. Be not drunk with wine, which is excess, but be filled. Come on, church, be filled this morning with His holiness, with His righteousness, with His grace.
Tuesday morning, if you can't make it, both of them,
one tonight, Lord Jesus, morning. Amen. But we will be here each morning in prayer. And if you miss Monday night, don't miss, by all means, don't miss Wednesday night. Amen. And I'm going to give it my best this week. Amen. We're going to have some prayer from the old school. Sunday evening group at 5 o'clock. We've got a pretty powerful group. Amen. Some good people. And we got a powerful group on Wednesday morning at 10. Very powerful, very powerful. You see some of them shouting today. Let's all stand. God bless you. We'll see you Monday night. That time is. And we just want to say we thank God for all of those volunteers that have helped us. Some came in yesterday and they did a wonderful job of the church.
Yeah.
And we just thank God for those volunteers. And also we thank God for those that have agreed to help with the yard. We're going to need your help real bad this week because Sunday is the big day. We got to get this yard cut and the church clean. I think that announcement has already been made for Saturday morning. Amen. Now, unto him.